Donald Trump is projected to win the presidency of the United States of America. He's projected to win the swing states, the electoral college, but also the popular vote. So let's have a conversation. Let's have a conversation. And the first part of that conversation is going to be focused on this. Why did Kamala Harris lose? And the overall answer is going to be that the Democratic Party made several mistakes. Let's go into each of those without wasting much time. And we can have a conversation, I think, more honestly even than the Americans can, because sometimes when you're dealing with this from an American perspective, you're not going to be able to have an honest discussion because the emotions are heated. Everybody still feels one way or another, but we can have a conversation. We're far away. We're in Africa, right? And we must then have a conversation after this also about what does this mean for Africa? Because we're not Democrats, we're not Republicans, we're Africans, right? This is the dissection. It's coming from Africa, right? So let's have a conversation. Why did Kamala Harris lose? Number one, Joe Biden broke a significant promise. Joe Biden promised to be a transition president. He promised to be a one-term president who was going to allow a new generation of Democratic Party leaders to take over. Then he changed his mind. And he wanted to run for a second term. This was a broken promise to voters. And I think the party should have pushed back at that particular point and actually asked him to honor his pledge. You said you were going to be a one-term leader. Your one term is coming to an end. Let us actually make moves and strategic maneuvers to prepare our electorate for that transition and actually start profiling significant leaders who can take over from you so that when they go to primaries, they have a real chance. So that's the first thing. I think that was a mistake, and it was a mistake that was made by the Democratic Party in failing to push back on Joe Biden. Number two, I think that the Democratic Party and those who were close to Joe Biden did not raise concerns about his age early enough. There were so many clips online with worrying issues about Biden's age, but these were dismissed by mainstream media. However, if I could see it from Africa, imagine how Americans who were closer to the action were seeing it and were concerned about those same issues. Imagine what was happening in American households around Joe Biden's age, around his mental acuity, and whether or not he was going to be able to execute his role as head of state, not only for one term, but at the time for a second term, because most of this year we were working under the assumption that Joe Biden is actually going to be the Democratic nominee and contest again. And even though the polls were showing that he's not going to beat Trump, the Democratic Party stayed with Joe Biden for too long, right? The third mistake is that the Democratic Party failed or did not want to do a primary. They had this perception that doing a primary will create unnecessary challenges for Joe Biden. They wanted to back Joe Biden. They wanted a clean, simple election. But that actually weakened the party, and it weakened the internal debate that they needed to have. And it took away a litmus test that sometimes having a primary allows you to have with the electorate, with the party, with the grassroots of the party. So if the Democratic Party had had a primary, I think that they would have picked a different candidate from Joe Biden. I think we would have been able to see the issues with mental acuity, about age, all of those things early, and they would have been able to pick a candidate who was more in touch with the American youth, with the American progressive movements, with various coalitions that you need to bring together in order to be able to win as a Democrat. Failure to do a primary in and of itself was a big mistake that led to an easy race for Donald Trump. So that's something that we need to note. Number four, the debate, the early debate, Joe Biden versus Trump, that was a disaster. That was catastrophic. I don't have to explain much further. You saw it. Trump was able to have very shining moments. I don't know what this guy said, and I don't think he knows either. And it proved that a debate can be something very useful for letting the electorate make a decision or have an eye on the caliber and quality of a leader who's contesting leadership. Donald Trump was able to get an upper hand in that particular debate. And because that debate happened when it happened, that then created crisis for the Democrats. Obviously, the fact that it happened earlier gave them a second bite at the cherry, so to speak. Then they made their next mistake. And this is my fifth point. The rush to replace Joe Biden with Kamala Harris did not feel democratic. When Barack Obama congratulated Joe Biden for stepping down, he actually called for a primary. He called for a speedy primary process that would pick a winner, but that's not the direction that they went, because Joe Biden then backed Kamala Harris and then created this consensus movement around Kamala instead of actually allowing there to be a primary. I think that if there had been a primary, that would have been good for the party even at that late stage, because it would have given whoever comes out of that feeling that they are a winner, would have given a credibility, and it would have actually allowed for a message to be something that came out from that particular process. So I think that the fact that they said, no, these are already pledged delegates, they're all going to go to Kamala because Kamala was part of the ticket, et cetera, those things at a certain level did not feel democratic. And even though Democratic Party elites were insisting that, no, it's fine, it's still in line with democracy, they were not then able to make certain types of arguments, because you can't say you're defending democracy and that you are the party of democracy, but at the same time, you are going through a coronation process for Kamala Harris. That, I think, is something that affected their legitimacy. I just realized my call is not fixed on the other side. But we'll go on. Please, please, please excuse my tardiness in that respect. So that was the fifth thing. The sixth thing, and I think this is a big issue, is around the failure of Kamala Harris to give a clear and unifying message. You cannot win an election on vibes alone. They have to be targeted messages that you distribute to different electoral groups that make them understand why they're going to vote for you. Right? Now, let's talk about some of the dynamics. And I'm going to speak about black men, and I'm going to speak about how some of the Kamala Harris message came across to black men. Right? Kamala was not going to be a popular candidate for some black men in key swing states, right? Such as Pennsylvania. Let's be clear, before I go on, let's be clear on something. Over 70% of black men in America who voted supported Kamala Harris. But there were some black men who did not like her record as a prosecutor in California. There are some black men who are criminal justice reform advocates who would not be necessarily enthusiastic about a candidate who is implicated in the incarceration of black men, particularly for crimes which they view as crimes which should not actually be prosecuted. For instance, possession of marijuana as one of the crimes, right? So we need to be very clear about that. Going in as a prosecutor, she was going to face challenges. We need to be very clear, because in the last election, 2020, one of the big moments was the George Floyd moment. And another one that followed after that was the Breonna Taylor moment. The issue of police brutality, the issue of the criminal justice system, the prison industrial complex, these were big issues, right? And the rallying call that came out of 2020 was Black Lives Matter. So Black Lives Matter advocates would have been concerned about Kamala Harris. And in fact, in the primaries for the 2020 election, Kamala did very poorly. She did not get 3%, up to 3% of the vote in those particular primaries because of her record as a prosecutor. It was not a record that worked for her. So this was already baked in and something that she would have been aware of, they would have all been aware of as a challenge that exists for their candidate, right? So we need to be clear about that going in. In spite of all of that, we must be very clear that black men are not the reason why Kamala Harris lost, but they didn't show up in the same numbers that they showed up for Barack Obama, and they didn't show up in the same numbers that they showed up even for Hillary Clinton or Joe Biden. Kamala Harris got the lowest number of black men voting for her comparative to the other candidates, but over 70% of black men still supported her, in spite of the issues that I've just outlined here. However, I want to now go further because I think you appreciate the nuance, right? When it came to the black men issue, the polling was already indicating that Kamala is having a problem with black men and she needed them to win particular constituencies, particular states, swing states, Georgia, Pennsylvania, etc. She needed them to come out in bigger numbers so that she could win. But they were ignored for too long. And when they paid them attention late in the race in October, they did not pay them attention in the right way. Two big mistakes were made. Barack Obama came out and gave a speech to black men where he basically spoke down to them. He lectured them. I like Barack Obama. I think he's one of the most talented politicians to come out of the American political space in the last 40 years, right? And his victory in 2008 is one that I supported. I discussed it in my last video, that he's actually the reason I got into politics in whatever shape or form. So I like Barack Obama. I don't like Libya. I don't like what happened in Libya. I don't like some of the stuff. I'm not saying it's perfect. We can have a conversation about Libya and other, and the Barack Obama track record in and of itself another day. What I'm saying is, when he came out as one of the top tier political black leaders in America, for him to speak to black men in a condescending way, to speak down at them, to lecture them, that did not create the appropriate response from the constituency. There's an old English saying, and that saying goes, you catch more flies with honey than with vinegar. Which means, if you can see that people are reluctant to do something, don't give them vinegar, give them honey. Make them want to do the thing. Talking down was a mistake, and it was a mistake that was made by Barack Obama. Then the Vice President Kamala Harris then outlined her opportunity agenda for black men. And this opportunity agenda for black men came out very late. Initially, she was saying, well, I'm not going to necessarily give a policy that is focused on black people, etc., etc. So that also would have made black men and other black people say, oh, well, then what are we doing here? You just want us to vote like sheep. Then they came with the opportunity agenda for black men. It was very late. It was not ambitious enough to get those men off the bench, to put on their jerseys and to get onto the pitch, right? Let's look at what that opportunity agenda for black men was speaking about. Number one, providing as many as 1 million fully forgivable loans of up to 20,000 for black entrepreneurs. Why 20,000? Why? It's a low number. It's a low number. If you're going to be promising things to black entrepreneurs, promise them the moon. You want votes. Promise them the moon. Promise them heaven, right? So I don't think it was ambitious enough. Then the other promise was further investment into training, mentorship, apprenticeship programs designed to help black men land jobs in high demand industry. Fine. Okay with that. Supporting a regulatory framework for cryptocurrency and other digital assets so that black men who invest in and use those assets are protected. Okay, I'm going to talk about crypto just now. And then legislation of recreational marijuana paired with a concerted effort to make sure that black men are able to access wealth and jobs in that market. Okay, let's talk about these. To offer black men weed and crypto would have been offensive to some of them. People who were concerned about the prison industrial complex, reparations, police brutality, to come and say, listen, black man, homies, hold this weed, hold this crypto, vote for Kamala. That would have really been condescending, disrespectful, and I think some of them were off-put by this. By the way, the crypto thing was never going to work because Donald Trump and Elon Musk have been pushing crypto much more than the Democrats have. It's a Republican thing. So if you think you're going to get a crypto guy to vote Democrat over a Republican, a crypto guy was going Republican before you even had the opportunity agenda. The opportunity agenda should have been something that spoke to big ideas within the black community, ambitious ideas within the black community. Maybe that would have been able to get them off the fence, those who were sitting on the fence, knowing and noting, however, that still over 70% of black men voted for Kamala. But you're talking about, how do we get that 30% that's on the fence? How do we get some of those who are now moving towards Donald Trump, moving towards the conservatives? They didn't do enough in that respect. If the polling is showing that black men are not showing up in the same numbers, why not bring out some influential figures from that community? For instance, they brought out Beyonce and Cardi B. But the whole time I looked at that and I was thinking, why don't you bring out Jay-Z? Kendrick Lamar was having the best year musically this year. Kendrick is the leader. Why not bring out Kendrick? Right? Kendrick Lamar, we gonna be all right. They not like us. They couldn't get Kendrick Lamar to come and sing the song "They Not Like Us" about Donald Trump. Just remix the words a little bit. Republicans, they not like us. They not like us. How did you not get Kendrick? Black women were always going to show up in high numbers. They are the most reliable voting bloc for the Democratic Party. And they did again. If you want to get black men and you're worried about black men not showing up, why not bring out J. Cole, Kendrick Lamar, bring out these trap rappers, all of these guys who actually have influence? Someone said Jay-Z was not going to do this because he has relationships with the NFL owners. The NFL owners are friends of Donald Trump, et cetera, et cetera. He's trying to make money from the NFL, and that's why he stayed away. And I don't think that it can be taken as implied that because Beyonce showed up, Jay-Z supports her politics necessarily. There needed to be a moment. Then at the very last minute, they bring out will.i.am. Will.i.am has not been relevant in the musical scene for a very long time. When he did the Obama song, Black Eyed Peas and will.i.am were actually up. Now will.i.am has been doing tech for a long time. He's not the musician that he used to be in the sense that he doesn't have clout and stature. All of the clout this year is in Kendrick Lamar's hands. He just defeated Drake. He just had that major moment. Why not bring him out? I'm just saying, if you want to get black men enthusiastic about your campaign, you put Kendrick, you put Jay, you put key figures in the community who are still respected. Going to Shannon Sharp at the very last minute, he's not necessarily going to lend his clout to you in the same way. Shay Shay is a platform that has interesting conversations, maybe gossip, etc., etc., can go viral, but it's not a platform with the kind of gravitas that is necessary. Just saying, this is how I see things, and that's how I see this particular issue. Then, having spoken about that, there's something that we need to speak about in terms of candidate quality or candidate talent. Kamala Harris did not have that thing. There's something that you need to get the world to back you. There was a lot that happened around her. Over $1 billion was raised for Kamala on ads, etc., etc. They had celebrities supporting Kamala, etc., etc. But at some point, the candidate has to have that thing. The candidate. Do you know or do you remember the Obama speech that created momentum for Barack Obama? He had just actually lost New Hampshire, the primary, to Hillary Clinton. But it gave this speech that people still remember. You remember the speech? For when we have faced impossible odds, when we have been told that we are not ready, or that we shouldn't try, or that we can't, generations of Americans have responded with a simple creed that sums up the spirit of a people. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. It was a creed written into the founding documents that declared the destiny of a nation. Yes, we can. I'm getting goosebumps just saying the speech. It was whispered by slaves and abolitionists as they blazed a trail towards freedom through the darkest of nights. Yes, we can. It was sung by immigrants as they struck out from distant shores and pioneers who pushed westward against an unforgiving wilderness. Yes, we can. It was the call of workers who organized, women who reached for a ballot, a president who chose the moon as our new frontier, and a king who took us to the mountaintop and pointed the way to the promised land. Yes, we can to justice and equality. Yes, we can to opportunity and prosperity. Yes, we can heal this nation. Yes, we can repair this world. Yes, we can. And so tomorrow, as we take the campaign south and west, as we learn that the struggles of the textile workers in Spartanburg are not so different than the plight of the dishwasher in Las Vegas, that the hopes of the little girl who goes to the crumbling school in Dillon are the same as the dreams of the boy who lands on the streets of LA, we remember that there's something happening in America, that we are not as divided as our politics suggests, that we are one people, we are one nation. And together, we will bring the next chapter in the American story with three words that will ring from coast to coast, from sea to shining sea. Yes, we can. 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 Thank you, New Hampshire. Thank you. Thank you. Obama did that. Obama did that. Obama broke through. After that speech, boom, the hits, boom, boom. Will.i.am made a song. The song was based on Obama's speech. Obama's words broke through. And this was not the first time he had a speech of that stature. The 2004 DNC, where he explained that he was a boy with a strange name whose life would have not been possible, but except for him being in America, Time magazine put him on the cover. And the question on the cover said, is he the next president? That's how significant Obama's political performance was. Let us not forget how improbable Obama's election was. A guy named, a homie named Barack Hussein Obama in America with a Kenyan father with a name that is very, very, very Arabic. Hussein. After 9/11. Come on, guys. Don't forget what the candidate did to take this thing over the line. He wasn't the favorite. I remember I was following Barack Obama from 2006. 2007, we went there. Hillary was the favorite. Obama had to do a lot. The political talent made a difference. The message made a difference. In retrospect, a lot of that message did not get delivered. Like, we are very disappointed about Barack Obama's performances in a variety of spaces, one of which is what happened in Libya. From an African perspective, Libya, Obama, Hillary Clinton, we have to talk. But that's not the topic. The topic that I'm trying to put across is that it was going to be difficult for Kamala to win. Always going to be difficult. She needed to have a moment. She didn't have a moment. All she gave us was that one phrase. What can be unburdened by what has been? What can be unburdened by what has been? That does not match Obama's message. I'm sorry, it doesn't match. And it actually leads more to confusion. I understand what she was trying to say, but it leads more to confusion. It has no detail. It doesn't bring me in the way Barack Obama did. Just go watch that Yes We Can speech. See how it makes you feel. Even today, go watch it. Something special that he put together in that particular moment. Now, I want to be fair to Kamala Harris. I want to be fair to her and say the following. Number one, the economic indicators were not in her favor. All of the Biden years were high inflation years. That didn't work in her favor. Number two, the fact that there were two wars, one in Ukraine, one in Israel, between Israel and Hamas and Lebanon, that was not something that was going to work in her favor, right? Because the Ukraine war on one side favored the Republicans because they are saying, why are we spending all of this money in Ukraine? And there was all of that scandal around Ukraine, you know, because of Hunter Biden, etc. So to be fair to her, she wasn't going to perform well in that particular race from the jump. Let's be very clear. Because of these dynamics, right? Ukraine was not going to do well for her. Then when it came to the conflict between Israel and Hamas, Israel and Hezbollah, the issue is that in one of the big swing states in Michigan, there's a large Arab American population. They were very unhappy with the fact that Kamala Harris indicated that she was going to continue with the Biden approach to dealing with the conflict. And Biden is somebody who's been very supportive of Israel. So the war did not help her. It did not help her prospects. On both ends, the two big wars did not help her prospects, right? So economy, not in her favor. The wars, not in her favor. Then there's something that we have to speak about as well. There are issues of racism and sexism, which were not necessarily picked up by the polling, but clearly still exist in America in a big way. Let's be very honest. The United Kingdom has had three women prime ministers in the last 40 years. Margaret Thatcher, Theresa May, and the cabbage duration prime ministership of Liz Truss, because they put a cabbage and they put her, and they said the cabbage would have stayed fresh much longer than her prime ministership because it was chaotic, right? But they've had three. You have to count Liz Truss, she counts. Even that 30 days or whatever it was, it counts. Three in the United Kingdom, right? Very progressive. Could have been more, should have been more. Three, right? The Conservative Party has just picked Kemi Badenoch to be the leader of their party, meaning that if the Labour Party were to lose, and the Labour Party is not doing well right now, but obviously there's still a long way to the next election, but if the Labour Party were to lose the next election, it basically means that the next Prime Minister of the United Kingdom is very likely going to be a Nigerian woman, a black woman. Nigerian. So not only has the United Kingdom given Theresa May, Margaret Thatcher, Liz Truss, they are most likely going to give us Kemi Badenoch, right? And even now, they've given us the Chancellor, right? Who is basically the Minister of Finance, who is a woman. So how is it possible that the UK has done all of this? We've seen Angela Merkel in Germany, several other leaders, New Zealand, so many in the Nordic countries, women leaders. America has been independent since 1776. By 2026, the United States of America will have been a democracy for 250 years. 248 years old now as a democracy. But in all of that time, in the land of the free, the home of the brave, they've never had a woman leading the country. 250 years! You can't tell me that there's no issue there with a little bit of sexism. Add a black woman to that mix, there's a racism issue. There are still issues in America of racism and sexism. And Kamala Harris was going into that. It was never going to be easy for her. It was never going to be easy for her. And to be fair to her, inheriting the wicket from Joe Biden at that last minute to try to bring it back from here was always going to be a difficult job. And I want to point out that sometimes when people have messed up in companies, corporate South Africa, that kind of thing, guess what they always do? They always hire a black woman to be the CEO. When they've messed up everything, then they're like, bring a black woman to save the day. And then that black woman ends up taking all of the blame. I don't think all of the blame rests on Kamala Harris here for this defeat. I think that the Democratic Party takes a lot of the responsibility, and they have to introspect, and they have to make a lot of changes. They have to. Otherwise, they're not going to bounce back from this easily. They're not. This particular moment is one that they really have to be very, very introspective. Some of the stuff around gender identity may have gone too far. They may want to talk about that. I think that at some point, the woke conversation kept getting too extreme and lost a lot of mainstream people, right? And that's a conversation that they need to have. How do they get back to the center? How do they focus on issues of social justice, which have enough traction to bring most of the party? Even if you and I, and there's a debate whether we do, agree that, you know, a transgender woman is a woman, are you going to be able to bring together every person who's a member of the Democratic Party on that issue? Are you? If you're not, is that one of the issues you want to put front and center in your campaigning? Maybe not. Maybe not. So the social justice movement and the progressive movement has to really think about what are the strategic priorities and the issues that they can take across the line and take across a majority of people. If they had done more prison reform in the last 4 years under Joe Biden, maybe they would have won this election, because that's something that can bring a lot of people with you. But they didn't. They did the anti-Asian hate bill, but they didn't do a significant amount of things for the black community, while it was the black community that brought Joe Biden across the line in the last election. They brought him across the line in Pennsylvania. They brought him across the line in Georgia. At what point do you not give back to that particular constituency and community? That they should have done something. Unfortunately, Obama didn't do enough for the black community. Joe Biden didn't do enough for the black community. When you take those things together, the black community, you're going to lose some people because that's 12 years. Of course, there's a Trump presidency in between, but I'm now thinking, I show up for the Democrats, they don't show up for me. And you can't blame voters for being at some level transactional like that. They're supposed to be. And in fact, black people have voted too much for the Democratic Party that I think that they've stopped being taken seriously as a constituency with needs that need to be met. If your vote is guaranteed, you're always the last person to be considered. You're like the first child or the middle child. Which one is the one that is the most ignored? I don't know what the psychology says, but the most behaved child sometimes gets the least attention from the parents. Just they're behaving. Why would I pay attention to them? And that's what black people have been for the Democratic Party for too long. The party has to introspect. But we are Africans. We are not Americans. Right? What must we do as Africans? We must take time to understand what the Trump agenda is going to be. He was very critical of China during the campaign and in the last years of his presidency. He wants America to be in a stronger position. He, towards the end of his presidency, seemed to be more interested in Africa because Mike Pompeo visited Africa 3 times in 2020. 3 times, significant number of times. And he was speaking a lot about giving business loans to Africans, development finance for African small businesses. Trump understands that America is losing in Africa. China is dominating Africa. Russia is dominating Africa. America needs to find a way to reconnect with Africans and to regain its influence in Africa. If you're a global power, if you're worried about, you know, another hegemonic state coming up and taking your number one position, you're going to be looking at places and spaces where that other entity is getting support. In America, in Africa, China, lots of strong relationships. America, you are far. You are far. So as Africans, what does that mean for us? Trump is a deal maker. We have to be deal makers now. We have to be transactional. We have to play the game for our benefit. These entities, China, America, Europe, whatever, UK, when they come here, they're not coming here because they love us. They're coming here because we have cobalt, we have coltan, we have copper, we have resources that they need to make their laptops, iPhones, cars, rockets, robots, whatever. We need to be transactional. For too long, Africans have just been welcoming people who show up in a boat. Ah, hello, come here, take some land, let's farm together. Chiki chiki, what is this apartheid? What are you, what did you think they were coming to do? You thought they were coming to befriend you. Have you seen the weather on the ocean? Nobody comes through that weather to be your buddy. We need to be transactional. We need to be selfish. We have to play the game for our benefit. If America is saying America first, we must be saying Africa first. You want to be number one here on the soil of the Africans. We want to be number one in our home ground. So what are you going to bring us that helps us become number one to ourselves? That's the deal we need to be making with these people. As Africans, it's time for us to stop. We're not part of the Republican Party. We're not part of the Democratic Party. We're not part of the Tory Party. We're not part of Labour Party in the UK. We're not part of the Chinese Communist Party. We are Africans. And we have to put our own agenda first. So it's important for us to understand and learn from this historical moment, because it is a historical moment. But it's time for us to focus on us and ask ourselves, how do we maximize these relationships? And how do we prevent these leaders who call themselves our leaders from using these transactions in ways that undermine us? Because these guys are rushing to Trump right now. They're sending WhatsApp. Hey, congratulations, my Trump. Africa loves you. Wada, wada, wada. We can't be, as the people on the streets, circumvented by these billionaires who call themselves our leaders. It's time for us as well to start talking directly to the Americans, Republicans, whatever. Let's talk to them. Let's make deals for us. Poverty is going up in Africa, sub-Saharan Africa. I don't know if you knew that. We can't continue to have the game played on us while we sit back and watch and pick sides. When elephants fight, the grass suffers. What if the grass can move? Why must we be the grass every time? Why must we be the grass? No, we don't have to be the grass. We must move. Let them fight on the dust. We as the lawn, the grass, we must water ourselves and watch this thing. This is not right of admission reserved. Every time you want to fight as elephants, you must come here. Cold War, you are fighting here. Messing up DRC, messing up Angola. By the way, some of these countries are still in a mess because of the Cold War, which was not our fight. So let's pay attention and let's move strategically. I don't know what you guys think. Are you following? Are you watching? Did you expect this result? Let's have a conversation. Till the next one.